morning. It's Saturday the 24th of August 2013. My name is Sarah and this is the Dreaming in Fibre podcast. I am coming to you this morning from the van because we are on our way to Glastonbury Wool Festival. It is a two-day show in Glastonbury, Somerset, and I shall be in the town hall with the other vendors. There's lots going on throughout the town. I think there'll be a sheep wool tomorrow, I think, and there'll be other bits and pieces going on in the church hall opposite us. I think they're doing a sort of sample and make day with different crafts. Up in one of the fields there's alpaca and sheep. I think there are other things around the town as well, and of course all the local shops and cafes will be getting involved and probably doing some special things as well. So quite a lot to look forward to. I am with Darren today, but we're also with Patch, so I'll just pan that around and see if you can see her. Patch, are you going to say hello to everybody? Hello, baby. Good girl, good girl. A little bit of a tail wag for you there. So Patch is already Glastonbury'd up with her nice tie-dye seat cover. And of course, in the front there, you can see Darren. And beside me, you can see lots of boxes, and behind me, lots of stock and things. We are in a smaller van today. This is ours, and it just makes it a little bit cheaper when we're doing what I class a smaller show than, say, Wonderwall Wales and so on. So, not so many costs involved for me today, which is quite nice. So don't feel quite so under pressure to sell, which makes it a little bit of an easier show. I think I've got quite a few customers coming to see me today, which is going to be quite nice. It'll be also be nice to meet new people as well, because, you know, often, as with all shows, you meet quite a lot of new people and start chatting and make new customers and new contacts as well. So quite interested for that, quite excited for that. I've got a little spindle project with me today that I might try and crack on with if I get chance. Hopefully I won't get chance, but if I do, it would be quite nice to get that done, because that's sampling a new colour that I'm going to be hopefully stocking quite soon when I get back to my hand dyeing. Later in the show, once I've gone through Glastonbury with you, I will, back in the studio, I'll talk a bit more about the shop update. We've got some exciting new things, so please stick around for that. I have some Chalgo needles that I now stock, some Rosy Retro stitch markers, which I now stock, and I'll have a few other bits and pieces as well that are new. So lots of interesting things for you to see this time, so do stick around for that. I'll probably also talk through some of my works in progress and some of my finished items as well, so we can catch up on that. And anything else I think that's kind of important to tell you this month. I'll probably also talk a little bit more about my getting back into hand dyeing again after my abstinence for health reasons, and we'll talk about how that will start to filter through into the shop and how that will affect possible ordering of said items in the future. Please do stick around. Today I'll leave you here this morning, and hopefully if I get a little bit more of a chance later on, I shall be taking you on a video tour of the vendors' town hall, and then I'll sure give you a bit of a close-up look at my stall, and possibly if we get a chance, Darren might do some videoing sort of around the town, which I will splice in. So hopefully a fun patch show for you. Okay, so stay tuned. Cheers. Okay, so this is my stand. Got bats, hand dyed tops, the final remaining ones. Got my Rolags,
as well, which are all packed up. Another bat wall. Rest of my last batch of hand dyed Shetland at sale price. Got some bonbons, some hand spun yarn, little spindle kits, and my texture boxes. Got some hand dyed fleece, hand dyed teas, water, and then my water. These are new. My little stitch markers from Rosie Retro. Cute. And then my other new product, which is my hand decorated felt balls. Felt balls on their own. Needles. Handles. Needle felting stuff. Protein stuff, and then my fleeces down the bottom. So that's my stand. And this is the rest of the hall before people arrive. Show.
Say hello.
Right. That is Glastonbury Tour, and we look like we're about 15 miles away from it at the moment. Apparently we're going to try walking it, and I will show you a little bit nearer the time the walk as we go up there. Alright,
speak to you later.
Right, so we've walked the length of this road. Knackered already because I've got a really heavy bag and the dog. You can just about see the tour through the trees there, and I think we've got to go up around the corner. Just got to try and find our way into it now. Alright, speak to you later. I think this is the bottom of the actual tour itself. This is like a public footpath. But as you can see, I don't think you actually see how steep that is, but it looks like it's a 45 degree angle. Wish us luck. Patch, looking forward to going up there? Patch? Hey? Looking forward to going up? No, she says. Anyway, I'll give you a view from the top, hopefully. See you later.
Right.
Yes, that was the start, so I'm hoping that we should be up there within probably about half an hour, maybe an hour. And take it really slowly because it is very, very steep. But as you can see, I've walked patch. I'm walking patch on the extension lead now. And I have actually got the Littlest Hobo music going through my head. So it's a shame I can't film her constantly whilst we're moving up and down the tour. Oh dear, I'm actually shattered already. Right, okay, catch you a bit later. Let's see, actually, I might try and walk just to show a little bit. Morning. Bit of hobo music going on in my head as Patch goes sniffing around. And she's done all the way up the road, stopping at absolutely everything to sniff it and try and eat it if it's possible. Right. Patch, this way. From a patch eyes view, actually, it'd be really quite good to maybe get a little camera and put it on her collar. It'd be quite funny, although some of the things she sniffs, I don't know if you particularly would want to see. Oh dear, I feel my age now. Right. Oh. Right. You in a little bit. This bit reminds me a bit of Lord of the Rings on the way up to Shelob's lair. 1,000 more steps to go. Look at this view already. Look at that. I'm not even anywhere near the top yet. Fabulous. Look at the sky. Absolutely amazing. Can't wait to get to the top and show you proper views from up there. Right. Oh, Patch is waiting. On we go. Ready? On we go. Right. The sky's grey, it's still actually really, really nice. Very, very warm. Wish I hadn't worn my coat, I just thought it was going to rain. Isn't that always the way? Okay, and those are the steps leading down. So you don't really get an idea of how steep they are, unfortunately, but if you do come this way, oh dear, make sure you bring a walking stick or some sturdy shoes, I tell you. Lovely, okay. Right. Onwards and upwards. Okay, we've stopped halfway, I think. It's right up there, so just sitting on a bench, just thought we'd have a quick stop and I'd give Patch some food to help lighten the bag a little bit. Unfortunately, she was hungry, although she wouldn't eat from a bowl, she had to eat from my hand for some unknown reason. But that's great. Again, just amazing, amazing views. There's Glastonbury itself, the town. Loads of greenery around, it's absolutely lovely. Quite a nice breeze actually, which is really nice up here. Okay, and here we are at the top, and this is what is right at the top. It's a tower. I'm not too sure the history of it or anything, but I imagine it's probably got something inside which I can go in a photograph or read in a minute. But this is the view. It's right at the top, see if we can get a panoramic view. So I've walked all this way. That is all the way around. Fantastic. Absolutely knackered. Gonna give it about 3 hours before I start walking out again. Catch you later. This is a view from the other side. Again, it's just green, 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 green. A few hills in the distance. Oh, and back the other way because I am wrapped up in Patch's lead. Patch almost pulled me off the side of the hill. And they're busy eating rabbit poo. Very nice. Come here, Patch. Patch. She's actually been very well behaved. She's been sniffing everything, but very interested in everything. Meeting a few people on the way up. It's almost a shame to have her on the lead, really, but this side is so, so steep. In fact, she's pulling me off this side. Come here, Patch, come here. You see the sheep down there? I think she's looking at them. Sheep over there. Someone's got a couple of sheep over there. There's actually some standing stones in the field. If you can see that, the middle one, the middle one of the three there. Looks like there's actually a circle in the middle of those. So that's just the way the sheep have lain. Probably. She's so impatient, she wants to drag me down the hill. But, yeah, it's just absolutely amazing up here. Sunny day. Actually, I think that'd probably be quite unbearable because it's actually quite warm now, even though the wind is blustery. Patch, come here. Come on. Good girl. And there she is. Patch. Good girl.
Sunday the 25th of August. It is day two and final day of Glastonbury Wool Festival. I am on the way. We've just literally left Crediton now and are on our way to Exeter. It's a bright and sunny morning, so the weather looks promising. It's supposed to be a lot warmer today as well. It wasn't cold yesterday, but I think we've got temperatures in the 20s at last. After the last couple of weeks, it's been a bit cooler than our heat wave, which I guess is a thankful release from the heat of that heat wave, although it doesn't compare to other countries' heat waves. For us, that was
12.
Yeah, it was quite a heat wave. And so it would be nice to have a little bit more warmer weather for the end of summer over the next week, if what they're promising us is correct. Yesterday, how did yesterday go at the show? It went all right. Yeah, it went all right. If you are a viewer from previous episodes, you will remember that I've not been able to dye as much of the normal product that I would have for a show like this. So my braids, yarns, all of that kind of thing. So I was really limited as to what stock I could bring today. So I was carding like mad and brought extra bats. I also, a few days before the show, started to decorate new products like my felt beads. All of those things had a really good reception yesterday, and I was really grateful to everybody who purchased, because it meant a lot to me that, you know, other products were supported as well as, you know, my hand-dyed braids would have been. I think footfall was possibly down on last year. I'm not entirely sure on that. There's a lot of interesting conversation amongst the other stallholders. A lot of people were saying that people felt that it was too expensive to come in this year, so they didn't pay to come in. Instead, they watched things like the sheep walk, which comes down through town, so obviously that's free. And then went into, you know, the boutiques and cafes, and just had a general Glastonbury day out. So that was a shame if that was actually the case. I don't know whether this year people just are finding it a little bit more difficult as well. I mean, obviously, you know, you have to still account for our failing economy. It's, you know, it's not getting any better anytime soon. So I think people are, you know, as time progresses, getting ever more cautious about what they spend and how they spend. There are still a few who splurge at these events because, you know, obviously it saves them on postage if they don't have to buy online, so they'll get as much as they can between each show that they attend. But for those who might normally splurge, you know, they might be more inclined to spend a little bit less this time instead working from their stash, because let's face it, we've all got a stash. We might deny it, but we've all got a stash somewhere. So you know, you have to take into account that some people might be spending less because of that. So I would say down on last year, but there are lots of factors that bear that into account. Also, a positive side is that now with the van that we've got, it means that I don't have to hire a van. So if I look at what I made compared to last year, in relative terms, I made roughly about the same as I did last year on the first day. So in that sense, it's great, because obviously I haven't had the expense of hiring a van, which is, you know, about a couple of £100 in itself. Because it's a bank holiday, I'd have to have it for all of those 3 days, plus the Friday and the Tuesday, the picking up day and the dropping off. So that makes hiring vans quite expensive when you're working over a bank holiday. Also, then there's petrol and there's food to factor into account, and we're spending much less this year actually managed for one of the very rare occasions to make things like sandwiches and stuff like that. So, you know, I would say we're probably in about the same position monetarily as we would have been last year. So fantastic. It was really great to meet existing customers and to meet relatively new customers who'd just come to the site and, you know, might have phoned me and asked me if I was going and asked my advice on projects and so on. So it was nice to put, you know, those emails and phone calls to faces, as it were. It was also great to meet some new potential customers as well, so hopefully that will have a follow-through effect onto the website. So yeah, quite positive really. I'm not sure what to expect from today. It's a Sunday. You're going to get two types of people. You're going to get the die-hard Fibreistas who come out because they've come to Glastonbury for the weekend and they might have forgot to buy something yesterday, or they had a good look round yesterday and want to really buy today. And they're generally quite good customers to have because obviously, you know, they'll be looking to stock up. So it'd be quite a good opportunity if we have a few of those come to the stand today. The second type of customer will be your Sunday stroller. You're going to get them no matter what show you're doing. So I would say, as a general rule, Sundays are usually slower, and I don't foresee today being any different to that. But also being a Sunday, also being quite knackered, it will be a nice day for me on the stall, because it means that I'm not so overtired, I'm not getting my words muddled when I speak to people. I can do simple maths in my head without requiring a calculator. It would be quite nice and less embarrassing for me. So yeah, I mean, it is what it is. And I will hopefully give you a roundup either at the end of today, or I will see you back in the studio. Okay, so I will see you soon. Cheers. I forgot to show you a special person who ran herself ragged yesterday up and down the tour. So here's Patch. She's, as you can see, pretty comatosed. You right there, Patch? You're looking forward to going up the tour again, are you? And that's about as much as you're going to get out of her this morning. And that's one tired Darren as well.
Morning.
Who also went up the tour. So I shall see you later. Cheers. Hi and welcome back to HQ. It is August 31st today, I think, a Sunday. I thought I would do a little catch up with you back in the studio after Glastonbury Wool Festival. Give you a little bit about my month in review, talk about Glastonbury Wool Festival again, give you a little bit of information about shop update and about some of the projects I'm working on, and also update you on some new customer pictures that I've had come through this month. I think what I will do with those, with my sort of works in progress, finished products, and the customer pictures, I'll probably do a bit more of a sort of photo gallery style finish to the show, and that way you can catch up on those. And you can find details of any knitting projects and things on my Ravelry page, where I am Sarah's Texture Craft. So, you know, make sure you come and friend me over there. Okay, so month in review, August. I can't think of anything off the top of my head that was, you know, sort of particularly stands out about August. Thankfully, August has been quite busy for me. Usually, August is quite a slow month in terms of selling. I think that's obviously because August traditionally should be a month where we all have fantastic summer heat waves, and so you really don't want to spend your time spinning, knitting, felting, weaving with wool, because your hands get too sweaty and you can't handle the product, and let's face it, sunny days, those rare sunny days are for other things like popping off to the beach and so on, and you know, that's understandable. So usually, traditionally, I would use August as my kind of development month. It would be the time when I experiment. I would catch up on scheduling posts for my Learning About Wool website, and just, you know, sort of come up with new products and things to release in the fall or early January. This month has been a little bit different, I think because I missed all of June really, having been ill. August was still very much a catch-up month for me and was quite busy shopping, I think, where people had waited for me to come back to work, which is fantastic, and as I say, quite unusual, so pleased with that. I still have managed to do a bit of development, which is quite nice, so I've got a few new products that I'm working on behind the scenes, and of course I was able to roll out things like my Rolags and things in last month's shop update, and I've spent quite a lot of time carding this month, carding Rolags for customer orders and things, which has been absolutely fantastic. So thank you so much for embracing that as a new product here at Sara's Texture Crafts. I really appreciate that, and I've got lots of new ideas and new colourways in the offing for future Rolag designs. I will give you a bit more info on new options on the Rolags when I talk about the shop update. Also, month in the review, just going back to Glastonbury Wool Festival. I think attendance was fairly good. I think, you know, I did quite well on the stall. I think it was quite a good show for a few people, really. So I'm looking forward to doing that again next year if possible. I think I will probably change up some of what I do on the stall for next year, but I'll probably talk about that closer to the time to sort of give you a bit of an idea if you plan to come. But it's definitely an event worth coming to if you live sort of locally. I don't know how big it would be in terms of vendors if you were travelling cross-country, but if you do happen to be down that way, then certainly that's a show to visit. And it might be one to look out for in the future if they get to a point where they can grow and have a lot more vendors and a lot more to see and do. Of course, there is a lot more happening around the town aside from people like myself, the vendors in the town hall. There's the alpaca run down the high street, there's a wool fashion runway show, there's a make and do event over in the church hall that runs both days, all day long. And up by the rugby pitch you can see the alpacas and sheep and things like that, as well as going to get, you know, some lunch and so on in the rugby club. So, as I say, there's lots to do, and I think they have plans to extend it for next year. So, you know, we shall see. Definitely a show to look out for. Shows coming up in September. The 6th and 7th, I shall be at the Torquay Embroiderers Guild annual exhibition. That's being held in Torquay. The exact details are on my website under the events page, so come and look for that. I've also got the full address and a Google map for you, which I hope is correct. So that's worth coming to and checking that out, because you know their work is always fantastic, and it's a new way of looking at crafting. I would say, even because I'm not an embroiderer, but even as a non-embroiderer, I find events like that fascinating, because some of the ideas that people come up with and use within their work quite often translate in a way, or you can think of a way of doing something similar within woolcraft. So, for example, weaving or embellishing or felting, that kind of thing. So it's always worth checking out shows like that for inspiration. And also just enjoying other people's creativity is always quite inspirational. So there's that to come and see. I will be there with a small, I think I've just got a table, so I'll have a fairly small selection of product. I'll have some merino with me, the 25 gram balls, as well as blends, I haven't got any hand dyed because I won't start hand dyeing until probably mid-September, when I'm sort of back to full strength, as it were. But I will have other things like bats, rolags, bonbon roving balls. I'll have some yarn as well, so that's worth coming to see if you want to come and grab some things from me. The next one after that, I shall be at Tedburn St Mary Weavers, Spinners and Dyers Guild. They are having an open day on the 18th of September, which is a Wednesday, I believe. I think that opens at 10, and I think it's a couple of pounds to get in because they're hiring a church hall. So no huge price to get in. That will just be a pop-up shop, so I will be the only vendor there. I will have a bit more choice. If I can get to the point where I can hand dye, there'll be a selection of hand dye. Otherwise, there'll be a good selection of all my other fibery goodness for you. That's always worth going to, not only just to buy from me, but just to catch up with people from the guild, particularly if you live locally, because it's a nice way to introduce you to the people before you pop along for your taster visit to their usual spinning day. I think that's it for events in September. In October, I have applied again for Woolly Weekend out at Kelly House, which is, I think, the 11th and 12th of October. It's that weekend in October anyway, whatever the dates are. And then a couple of weeks after that, towards the end of October, I shall be at the Devon Embroiderers Guild AGM, which is a private meeting. But if you are a member, come and see me, because I'll have a selection of wool fibres and hopefully some silky bits as well that are hand-dyed that might be of interest to you in your work. That pretty much, in terms of shows, will cap off my year here at Sara's Texture Crafts. I don't tend to do shows after that date, purely because the website is so busy, and I find Christmas selling, it's okay online because I have customers who, you know, sort of create wish lists throughout the year, if you like, and so I'll get people who'll buy for Christmas for those people, or people will buy to make things for Christmas. But for me to go to Christmas craft shows and things is generally not really good profitable business for me, purely because people are generally looking for finished articles rather than supplies. So I probably won't do any selling events now from October until the end of January, where I've booked to do Craft for Crafters again at West Point in Exeter. I will be teaching a little workshop. I think it's the last week in November. I'll come back to you with exact details on that. That will be another craft jam, which is an event held by the Craft Hub in Exeter, and I will be teaching needle felting again. We will be doing Christmas decorations from needle felting, so if you fancy giving that a go, check out the Craft Hub. You can find them on Facebook as the Craft Hub, or email me for details and I will send you a link. I don't think there are tickets open for that event as yet. It's probably still a little bit too early, but that's certainly one to keep in your diary to check out closer to the time. I will try and have a class big enough for as many people who want to be involved in that, so we'll see what the uptake is. I think last time I did it, I think I taught in January earlier this year, if I remember right, and I think I had probably 30 to 40 people, maybe slightly more than that. And because Darren does a bit of needle felting himself, he was able to help me sort of get round people. So I'd do the main teaching and he would help come round and just make sure everybody was okay for equipment and didn't have any sort of urgent questions that I would need to answer before I got chance to get around to them. So that could be quite interesting as well if you're in the area. Newsletter will be going out for those of you who subscribe probably towards the end of next week. I'll have lots of new product information and another full list of the shop update details as well,
and a link back to this podcast. If you are a member of the newsletter, do make sure to check out the newsletter when it arrives, because occasionally I'll be putting offers, coupons, that kind of thing in the newsletter, and that's sort of an extra loyalty incentive for those newsletter readers. You can sign up to that newsletter obviously on the website at sarastexturecrafts.com. If you have any questions at all, you can email me via the contact form there. I am open Monday to Friday, 9 to 5.30, so I will get back to you as soon as I can. What else do I need to tell you this time? I think that's probably it. Beyond the shop update, customers' work and what I'm working on. So let's move on to that. Sorry, this feels in a bit of a rush, but as I say, it's a Sunday and I've got a couple of chores to do, and so I thought I would get this in while I can, because I have builders working here during the week, fixing various things around the house at the moment. So this is kind of my only chance to sort of finish up our podcast. So let's get on to the shop update. Now, as I go through and mention what's in the shop update this month, which is all active as I speak on the website, I'm going to insert a picture so you can get a better idea, and a couple of the things I've actually got here with me which I can talk through and show you a bit more about. So we'll start with new bat colourways. I've got coloured Dartmoor and Rusty Gate. If you're a club member, you received those already. If you are not a club member, then they're now available to you on the website. The new club colourway will also be available next week. I don't have a picture for that because I'm still working on a new idea for that one. But that will be, up until now, I've done Merino, Merino Silk, Merino Tencel, Merino, you know, another fibre. This time round, I want to try and give you a bit more of a sort of mix of fibres, so I'm planning to do something Merino Shetland based and then a Merino Shetland and probably Silk based haze version. If you have seen those listings on the website, you will note that traditionally I have just a stripe version and a haze version. What's the difference in spinning? It means that depending on how you choose to spin from your bat, you should get different results from each. So do check out that club option and also the listing options, because obviously you can buy both, you can use one to complement the other. Also, if you are a club member, if you buy two, then I give you a small discount off, and that's only available for club members. They will then be full price when they come to offer to everybody else on the website, so check that out. That's a monthly listing, and you can you subscribe to it monthly. So you subscribe just for one hit of that and choose what
the next product
you want. Is a basic needle felting toolkit. This is something that I did primarily for the store, but I've now been asked to put that up on the website. It basically involves a pack of 15 felting needles, which are in three different gauge sizes. You get a tutorial that comes along with that. That's it's a 3D tutorial, small figure tutorial, and it gives you an idea of how to use your different gauge needles. So you start off with a 36 and you move right through to a 40, and it gives you, you know, a bit of an idea of when to swap and change those needles over. So particularly if you're a beginner felter and you've only used one needle before, then this is a little bit of a move on for you, and a little bit of a help in the right direction for choosing gauges for projects in the future. Also within that, you get the two wooden handles that I offer. So you get the needle handle for one needle and the needle handle for four needles. The four needles you won't need within the tutorial that I talk about, but it's always a handy tool to have just in case you're doing very large 3D work. or if you choose to do landscape work, because it just gives you a little bit more coverage within the same amount of felting time, because you've got four needles working at once. The next kit I have available on the website is my 15 gram spindle and merino silk blend. It's a small box, perfect for gifts, either to give to somebody you know who has just got into spindle spinning, or to try out yourself. It's quite a lightweight spindle, so you're going to be spinning lace with it. A lot of people have said to me, oh, you know, it's recommended that I pick a particular size to learn spinning on. Yes, traditionally you will probably choose a heavier spindle. I think the Ashford spindle is about 80 grams. That's the student spindle. The reason why you go for something so heavy is that it really helps you concentrate on drafting and learning to understand just how far you can pull fibres apart before they break. So it helps you get into a consistent drafting practice before you get on to using your other weight spindles. So yes, that is quite useful, but certainly with this kit there's no reason why you couldn't learn to spin on it. I've had several customers who have. As I say, you'll be looking to spin a lace weight quite early on because the spindle is quite light, it's not giving too much of a weight, and therefore too much of a sort of gravitational force on your draft area. So you should be able to spin really quite nice and fine. And of course, spinning with merino and silk, having that addition of that extra strength in the silk, because it's a longer fibre and it has a higher tensile strength, means that even as a beginner spinner, you should be able to pick up a consistent form of spinning quite quickly. So that's one to look out for. Next I have locks. I've been asked for this for a few years and it's just been one of those things I've never been able to get the time to do because of the amount of work involved. So excuse me for leaning out of shot there, but this year I managed to get some time to work on some Massam and some Tencel. So I've washed them and I've separated them into 10 gram amounts. This is a Massam, so you get quite a nice curl. There is ever so slightly a small amount of lanolin left in these, so if you're looking to use these for doll's hair, then you might want to wash it a little bit further, but they're certainly perfect for spinning either directly from the lock or tail spinning, that kind of thing, and you can wash out just the remaining lanolin in your setting of your yarn, or dyeing if you prefer to dye. So those will be available in the shop. They, as I say, take so long to do. You start off, you have to go through the whole fleece, not only do your usual sorting and processing of a fleece, but then you have to literally sit, separate all of the locks and then measure them. So it's quite wasteful actually if you're buying an entire fleece just for the purposes of making measured and separated locks, because obviously really the areas where you're going to get any real length is the saddle across the back, so it means the rest of the fleece would be classed as wastage if you were just using it for that particular purpose. Fortunately I use the other areas of the fleece for different things, so it's not quite so wasteful, but as I say, it's particularly time consuming because you have to measure every single lock. And then when you wash it, it's a much more intense process than it would be washing a larger amount of fleece, because you have to be very careful about trying to retain as much of the curl structure as possible. Whereas if you're washing a fleece for dyeing and things, you tend to be slightly less careful. That doesn't mean to say that I am quite happy to destroy curl structure on my fleeces and mane. That's something I always try to retain. But for measured locks, obviously that's extremely important, because quite a lot of the customers I have for that are looking for that perfect curl structure. So they are available. They are available in different widths, lengths. I've separated them into three different lengths, I think 20 to 25 centimetres, 25 to 30 centimetres and 30 to 35 centimetres. I had a couple that were longer and quite a lot that were shorter, so I've really tried to keep within those amounts, and those are directly available from the website. Also have a couple available on Etsy if you're an Etsy buyer. So that's something to look out for. What else have we got? Oh, I updated the website with all the Ashford weaving threads that I could find in their catalogue. So if you're a weaver and you're particularly looking for those finer weaving threads, I now have those available to buy. They are pre-order. I don't hold stock of those because I've only really had probably about 10 people in the last 6 months actually ask for them. So I'm not expecting to do sort of huge business on those, but if you are interested, I was ordering once a month from Ashford, but now I've got to the point where I'm ordering 2 to 3 times a month, which is fantastic. So it does mean that I am able to get something fairly quickly for you if they have it available in stock. Usually they tend to be pretty good with their stock, and if they don't have something, there's normally another shipment arriving quite soon. So there's never really a huge amount of delay on products. I think there are 4 different threads. There is, what I will do is I'll put the pictures here and I will give you a breakdown of what they are so you can see them. So I'm going to pop those in here. Okay, and the next product is felt ball beads. I've been asked for these for a while. People wanted me to hand roll them. I have to say, within my sort of time frame of my normal schedule of work, it's quite impossible for me to do myself. So what I've done is I've found a fair trade source. So these aren't British. They are made from merino overseas in a fair trade community. And I've got several different colours at the moment. These are fantastic for jewellery making, for felt making, also embellishing textile artworks or garments, that kind of thing. You can make brooches, rings. I also hand decorated some beads which I took to Glastonbury. Saw quite a few of those, so whilst I'm going to take the rest to the next couple of shows in September and probably release them on the website in October probably or early November. Those did quite well for me, so I'll need to update those. They will obviously be a little bit more expensive. These I'm selling in packs of 5 for £1.50. The hand decorated ones I think were £1.75 for 2. I'll pop in a picture to give you an idea of the colourways of these, and as I say, look out for the next couple of months and the hand decorated ones will come in. The next product I have, which is new for the website, is Chiaogu needles. Now, anyone who has tried these before, or for any of you who haven't but do lace, a lot of lace work, not necessarily on lace weight yarn, but lace work for shawls on other weights as well. These are fantastic to use because they are really sharp and pointy needles. They really pick up the yarn quite quickly and they're quite slick as well, so it's very nice to use these. The join is quite seamless as well, it's very smooth. So they make an ideal needle to have in your stash for when you're using come across a yarn that's slightly more difficult to use maybe and you need a sort of slicker and finer point. So those are available. I've got 3 cord lengths at the moment, which is the 24, 32 and 40 inches. And I've got mostly the smaller size needles, but if you are looking for something specific, then contact me And of course, I can order those for you within my next order to Chiaogu. I will be looking to stock the interchangeables and the sets as well at some point in the future, based on how well these do for me. So, as I say, keep an eye out for those. I've got some Blueface Leicester Curls in the website. Managed to get quite an amount of fleece this year, so I do have some fleece available for you. I haven't got as far as measuring and separating locks for those, but certainly there is raw fleece available. So grab that while you can, because obviously I do quite a lot of hand dyeing fleece, and once I get back to hand dyeing, I will then be siphoning off some of that fleece to dye to see me through the rest of the year, because as you know, fleece is a seasonal product, so I would expect to sell out of the majority of the fleeces over the next month or so. I've already sent some off to the mill to be processed into tops, and so I will have a new product which you can find under my coming soon section on the website, and that's for the Great British Wool Club. And essentially the idea behind it at the moment is that you will receive X amount of straight from the farm tops. So those are tops that I've had processed at UK based mills from fleece that I have sourced locally. So do keep an eye out for that on the coming soon section. You can also add your email for an alert for when that club goes live. I haven't got prices and full details on that yet. I'll be working on that over this month, hopefully to launch next month. So sign up, drop your email in, and as soon as that goes live, you'll have an alert come through to you via email. The final thing in the shop update was stitch markers. If I can find them down here. Yeah. I have just had... I've just had a new shipment of stitch markers, and I'm working with the lovely Rosie Retro, who you can find on Etsy. I've got two products from her. I've got these, the Rainbow Drops, and these are the Ringos. Now, the Ringos are snug free. They are the rings with the little bead on the side, so they're perfect for lace repeat marking and smaller projects. They go up to a 5.5 needle, whereas these pop drops go up to a size 10mm needle. These are great for working in the round, marking your beginning and end of the rounds. They're also great for lace work on those larger projects as well, because they hold work on a larger needle. So those are both really cute and available now on the website, and I'm really thrilled to be able to work with Tabs at Rosie Retro. She has some really great product, and this is kind of a new idea for me. I've decided certainly for shows it would be really nice to have a range, just a very small range of product that I work with local indie makers to create. So whether it be the stitch markers here, or buttons, or spindles, or something that's made by another independent, a local independent. When you receive their product, you will receive information about them and how to find them if you want to go direct to them in the future. But for me, it's more about having a more cohesive range of product on the stalls and on the website as well. I can't possibly learn to create the perfect stitch marker or the perfect button, or, you know, those kind of things. So sometimes it's best to sort of outsource that creativity and that expertise elsewhere. It gives me a fuller range to sell on the website, but it gives you an opportunity to buy creative, independent, good quality handmade product direct from one place, and buy that along with your fibre and yarn that you would buy from me. So that's something I'm working on. I'm hoping to add to that range and work with new independent people, and details will be coming on that quite soon, hopefully. The only other thing I was going to mention, I think, in terms of shop update was a hark back to the Rolex that I mentioned earlier, and just to give you a heads up that not only can you buy the Rolex in merino form, merino and silk blends, but you can now buy them in merino and sparkle, because I had a couple of people asking me for sparkle, and of course it didn't even enter into my little brain that that actually would be a good option. So thank you guys. That is now available on the website. So there's plenty of colours, plenty of new colours will be coming soon. So go grab some. Speaking of which, my first project that I've been working on that I'm going to show you today is working with some of my Rolex. So, bit of rustling. These are my Rolex in colourway Morocco. So I've hand spun these and I've plied them against a single ply of the sort of rosy pink colour that's in that. And I hope you can see a good colour of that. If you can't, I'm going to add some pictures. So that's my yarn. It's 100 grams. I haven't measured the yardage yet. But I've plied 50 grams of these against 50 grams of a solid merino in that pinky colour. Just to really give you an idea of how this might come out in a finished yarn. So I think you'll find that's come out really rather lovely. The version that I spun up had little bits of silk in it, so that gave me a slightly different look still, and this is destined to be turned into a product for exhibition, if you like, on the stall and on the website, to give you a bit more of an idea of how to use some of my product. And that's something that I'm going to be working on generally coming up in the next probably sort of 5 to 6 months. It's going to be a long-term project. I really need to make sure that I am sort of showing you different ways of using my product. I have a lot of particularly beginner spinners who are not used to spinning directly from a braid such as this, which is my colour Lightning. So they're quite confused as to how this braid might turn out if they knit it up. So I've worked on some samples. So for that colourway, this is the same colourway but on a Jacob base. Obviously I'm still knitting it so it's not blocked. This is a single, about 4-ply weight, but it just shows you if you spin directly from the braid without any sort of complicated prep of the braid into you know, any sort of specific form or chain plying or anything like that, you can create quite a nice gradient effect. That same yarn I plied against itself, and I'm going to knit that up into a sample so I'll be able to show you how this turns out compared to how it turns out as a single. So it will show you that you'll get the same colours, but it will be quite a different knit. Sorry again for leaning forward. This is colour Indian Summer. I don't have a braid with me, but I'll insert a picture here. To show you what the braid looks like. This is the single spun up, so you can see the variegation that happens on the braid directly onto a single yarn. And then again, I've two-plied it against itself, so that will eventually be a swatch to show you how that sort of method of spinning will differ how the colour works by comparison to knitting from directly from a single's yarn. So that's a project that I'm working on at the moment. That's going to be a long-term project, but I would quite like to do that for all of my colourways and for my Rolex as well. I'm going to work with a couple of customers on that who are going to help me to create some of that work. just purely because I haven't got the time to do it all of myself and go back to dyeing in a couple of weeks and create new colourways. And I've got Fibre Club up and running, which is a reminder, if you haven't booked your spot yet for Fibre Club, the prices for braids will be going up to £7 at the beginning of September. It's just got to the point where, with the amount of electricity, the cost of water and things like that, I just cannot afford to manufacture the product for the price that I was originally selling it for. Having had a look at the shows recently, the majority of the people who I would say are my level of competitors for the sort of quality of product that I'm producing, they're selling their 100 gram braids for anything up to £12, and that's a non-blend product, so that might be 100% merino, 100% blue face Leicester and so on. So £7, I think you can still appreciate, is a very, very fair price for what you're getting. So if you haven't booked your space for Fibre Club, then do that, because that club is sold, has been sold to you at the old price. So you're getting a bit of a bargain for this Fibre Club. So that's a good way of stashing up and getting, as I say, extra value for money for this coming season. A couple of other things I've been working on. I've got back to spinning in a bit of a big way. I'm going to show you some of my finished knitting projects in a second. It's a bit of a photo gallery. But now that I'm much better, feeling much stronger, I'm able to get back onto the spinning wheel. So I've knit up a few skeins now. This is one of my sample colourways against a natural Jacob. It's kind of quite nice, and I'm going to be knitting with that a pattern for a slouch hat that I created a few weeks ago. I'll show you this project picture now. This project was for my brother, who's just about to go travelling for at least the next couple of years, across America, Canada, New Zealand, that kind of thing. And so I gave him a slouch hat for when he hits that colder weather in those places that he's going to. I had a lot of interest from that on Instagram, Facebook, and so I decided I would write up the pattern. So I had to spin myself some more yarn. So those will go on the needles as soon as I can, and I'll get that pattern out hopefully by the next time I record. That will be an available pattern for you. It will be a free pattern, just purely because it's not a hugely complex pattern. It's probably something you could come up with yourself if you've knit quite a few hats before, so I probably won't charge for that, but it's just a good way of showing you how to use hand spun. So there's that. I think that's probably it for works in progress, so I'll show you that photo gallery now. And we're back. So I think the only thing left to show you today is my customer gallery. These are images of products that customers have sent to me where they have created things using my fibre. So there's quite a few, so I'm going to go through those one by one and give you indication of where they're from. In the show notes at dreamingandfibre.blogspot.com you'll be able to find links to those specific posts if you want more details on those particular projects. So before I get to that, I think I'll do my little sign off and leave you there for this month. So If you need me, you can find me at www.sarastexturecrafts.com. If you have any comments on this show, you can leave those on the show notes page at dreamingandfibre.blogspot.com. And I guess all that's left to say is just have a fantastic month, and I shall see you at the beginning of October, where hopefully we'll have lots more news on new fluff and things happening here at HAQ. So have a great month, and I shall see you soon. Keep dreaming and fibre, guys. Cheers.